Another edition of Sam Choy's in the Kitchen. I'm John Veneri. This is world-renowned chef Sam Choy, and we decided to take a trip to Waikiki to La Vie Restaurant.
And I tell you what, we're going to visit Chef Shaymus and Chef Patrick.
At the Ritz-Carlton, let's go. So happy to be in the kitchen.
In the kitchen.
Chef Shaymus, Chef Patrick.
Chef.
Thank you guys so much for having us here at La Vie. We were looking forward to this.
Heard.
Thanks for joining us. Yeah.
So what are we doing today, guys?
So we're going to make a tuna tartare today. So classic preparation for French cuisine tartare. In this case, we're going to grab nice local ahi to do that. And then we're going to set some Moroccan flavors on top of that. So kind of referencing a little bit of France's history.
You guys just recently reopened June.
Yes, June 5th we opened. We wanted to make sure that as soon as we were able to open that we could and try to get everyone back in the kitchen and back into the restaurants and back to working and enjoying life and what is the new normal as society. So we were excited to open up and it was just really nice to have everyone back in the restaurant itself and so many loyal patrons and being open for so little bit of a time.
Were you guys doing takeout?
We were doing takeout, but our big brother restaurant, High Steakhouse.
Yeah.
So we were actually part of a group that has three different restaurants over here. We've got Cuore Restaurant, which is our Italian restaurant, La Vie, which is a build-your-own French three-course menu, and then High's. And so we kind of took a little bit of everything and built a takeout program out of that, and we would send that out of High's.
It's the G Lion Group. We like you guys doing that, putting together some nice food. And speaking of putting together, Chef de Cuisine, what are you doing?
All right, so we just started with kind of like, think of it as a small cut poke here. So a little bit larger than what a Frenchman might cut their tartare to, but much smaller than what you'd cut your poke to.
Okay.
A little bit of Hawaiian sea salt, which is always good. So we just take that note from the local culture here.
I noticed you had poured some of this in there. What
yeah,
is this?
Yeah, so this is red peppers that have been confit with ras el hanout, which is a Moroccan spice blend. Anywhere from 30 to 100 different spices in there.
Wow.
Nice, sweet, savory, kind of deep kind of flavor in there. Nice. Used a lot with like stews and things like that. So it adds a real nice, deep quality to it. Mm-hmm. But thankfully, it's nice and light as well, so it doesn't overpower the ahi.
You put some mint leaves in there.
Yep, so a little bit of fresh mint, which is real popular. Preserved lemon zest as well.
Yeah.
So that's like a salty, sweet kind of action in there. And that's kind of the base, real straightforward, but a lot of deep
flavors.
Flavor.
Yeah. Well, you can tell because of the, all the different varieties of flavors that you're putting in there.
Yeah.
Is this dish got some heat?
No. So it does use like paprika chili pepper, but it doesn't use a real spicy pepper.
Okay, perfect for
so
me then.
So it's got more of kind of a sweet thing going on. Sweet spices like cinnamon and even dried rose show up in the spice blend. So it has kind of a very interesting.
Is this on the menu too, or they just when they're building the three course, they can choose something like this, Chef?
Yeah, so the fun thing is, you can build your own three course and you can go with an appetizer, entree, and a dessert, or you can do two apps and an entree. Whatever you want to curate for your experience is what the theory is behind the concept. Also, we're going to be later on showcasing things that are more in season and have another side of the menu that will be, if truffles are in season, we can add some truffles to that, or golden king crabs, or dry-aged beef of some sort, and so we're just expanding on that menu and as it evolves.
Now, what was this that you added right here?
Fried shallots, and then this is dried black olive. A little bit of dried chili thread, which doesn't add much heat, but has a lot of dried chili flavor. A little bit of chervil and sorrel to go with it.
Nice.
That looks really good. Now, tell me what it's accompanied with. What is this?
So these are eggplant chips. Essentially, it is a tapioca cracker with roasted eggplant puree mixed in.
Okay. That's it.
That's it, John.
That's perfect. Dish number one, done. The first dish looked amazing. Can't wait to try it, but I am looking forward to what you guys are doing next. What is it?
I'm gonna do a classic asparagus and poached egg variation here. So just start with a little bit of butter, which is always good. And then some asparagus and some Alii mushrooms.
Okay. More butter, more better.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Just kind of warm those up and just sort of get them happy again, seasoned up. And then we're going to dress them with a little bit of shallots reduced with white wine and tarragon.
Ooh.
So
tarragon is one of those things. Yeah, it just it gives a great taste.
Yeah, wonderful flavor, particularly with green vegetables like this. So in the same kind of family or profile is chervil, which is what we're going to make a nage that we pair with it. So essentially just a light broth, nice and herbaceous, finished with a little bit of cream.
You know, I was fortunate to cook with Roger Verger. He goes, we're making French mashed potatoes, right? So got the mashed potatoes, running it through the, what you call the ricer.
Mm-hmm.
And then he goes, I need butter. So we had about 5 pounds of mash, right? I mean, potatoes. I go, how many pounds of butter was? 10 pounds of butter.
Oh,
I'm like, oh, man, I tell you what. And we whipped it almost like a, you know, Bernaise sauce.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but it was really tasty. But man, that thing had so much butter in there. It was like, whoa.
No wonder you got guns.
Yeah.
Look at those guns.
That used to be the theory, equal parts butter to cream to potato.
Is
how you made the mashed potatoes at the French restaurant.
Yeah. I was so fortunate to work with him, though, you know, he's such a world-class gentleman, you know.
Yeah, that's an amazing experience.
Yeah.
I want to know, you know, during this entire pandemic time, did you guys stop and try to come up with new dishes, or you just try to perfect what you're already doing?
Well, absolutely, yeah. We stopped, we rethought about dishes, we rethought about possible concepts, we rethought everything. We were at such a loss of what it was going to be when we were able to open back up. Uh-huh. So. We didn't know what was coming, so we rethought it, we re-innovated and refined our dishes as much as we possibly could.
That's great. So this was already on the menu?
Yeah, 2.0 version this time around, though.
Okay.
Yeah.
So some good came out of the pause?
I think, yeah. You know, we try to look at the positive out of everything.
Yeah.
And so for the experience, you know, there's a lot of things that seemed like it would be more hassle, but now we know that everybody's on the same page for cleanliness and sanitation and protection amongst ourselves, other than just we know that we're doing it, but not everybody has to do it. So.
What do you got going on here?
So
you had, what was this that you had put in there?
So that's a truffle vinaigrette. Everybody likes a little bit of truffle, particularly with asparagus, also very classic. So this is a petite herb salad. So these are fiends herbs, tarragon, chervil, parsley, and chives.
And you're laying it on top of a nice little...
Yeah, so this is a cute little Gruyere tuile, or a little Gruyere crisp. So essentially just Gruyere cheese grated and baked till it gets nice and toasty.
Wow, okay.
And then...
That's really cool, I like that.
That's a really nice depth, you know, if you think about like your mac and cheese, and you get those crispy edges, you know, or like on a lasagna, that kind of, that bit you really like. It adds a real depth and strong umami to this dish that just kind of anchors everything. And then we finish with a little bit of toasted buckwheat here. So soba berries that have just been roasted in the oven give a nice deep nutty flavor. And then table side we finish with the chervil nage.
Chervil nage, what is that exactly?
So chervil is in the parsley family, has a little bit of a licorice flavor like tarragon, but a little more mild.
Mm-hmm.
So we use a little bit of veg stock cream, blend the two together, and then rewarm it to kind of bring it all together.
That's great. Well, we're just whipping through the dishes. Dish number two, done. Time now for bok choy. Everything in here, Uncle Sam has to incorporate into whatever he's doing here. You ready for this?
Yeah, I don't
know.
I'll
let you guys open it. This is the fun part.
All right.
There could be a lot. There could be not too much.
Oh boy.
That's a tough one.
This is a good one.
What's that there?
Miso.
Oh, perfect.
There you go, chef.
Thank you.
So how are you going to do that?
You're going to put that in there somewhere? We're going to just have shots of this.
We're going to say bye.
Oh, man. We're making a salsa, like a tropical fruit salsa, and then kind of like toss it all up and lay it down on a... pineapple slices here.
Okay.
And then we'll lay a burrata cheese on top of that. Garnish it with a little bit of cilantro.
Isolation got you down? Eating your way out of depression is actually not a bad idea, according to the Journal of Neuropharmacology, if you eat the right food. Bananas are chock full of tryptophan, a brain chemical that helps to regulate mood. They're also high in B vitamin folate, known to have antidepressant properties. Other tryptophan-laden foods include beans and dairy. For a super happy meal, combine yogurt with berries, which contain the flavonoid anthocyanidin, a mood-stabilizing drug. Complete your breakfast with a cup of joe. Caffeine stimulates the central nervous system and elevates serotonin and dopamine levels. That salmon fillet has omega-3 fatty acids to improve mood. Add some turmeric, which contains another depression buster, curcumin. Low levels of zinc have been linked to anxiety. One quick cure? Indulge in oysters. And there's my personal smile inducer, dark chocolate, source of antioxidants which reduce the stress hormone cortisol. Happy munching! Now back to Sam in the kitchen.
Just cutting everything all on the same size.
Same bite size.
Got some big chunks of strawberry, so I don't know who did this.
Ooh, ouch, calling me out.
Oh, did I call you out, John?
You did a little bit, but that's okay. I can handle it.
John, shit, why not? So the scary part is we're gonna use that miso.
Which really can be put on just about anything, right? Won't it add a little bit of the savory to this dish?
Yeah, it would, you know. But I'm already going to put a little salt.
Maybe it'll bridge the gap.
Maybe.
Yeah, it could be. Go. What we have in here is nice mangoes, tropical mangoes locally, pineapple, some red onions, some Spanish onions, and then just some salt, pepper, and I'm going to add some cumin to kind of give it that salsa flavor or look. And then I'm going to squirt some olive oil in it.
Looks like something that could be served here, huh?
Absolutely, yeah, it's beautiful. The mangoes right now are
yeah,
delicious.
Well, you know, that's the thing, right? And now we do the walk across the bridge here.
Let's see what happens.
This is a great sauce. Have you guys ever tried this sauce?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
This is a great one, yeah. I think I'm going to start off with just that much.
Since you have to use it.
It's in.
Just never would have ever thought of olive oil on mangoes.
I've used it, you know, before in other things, in like a salsa wrap, you know, and finishing it with this. So yeah, it does work pretty good. Okay, Chef, I want to have you line it up because you got the eye for that.
Right.
Since I messed up the strawberries, he's calling on you to put the thing down on there.
Straight shooter down the middle.
Yeah, right down the middle. Just some nice wads of that right there. Just naturally flowed.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
I like that you added the pineapple down on the bottom like that. That's great.
Very nice.
Now, this is burrata cheese?
Oh, maybe we can add.
Now, this is burrata cheese?
Big, huh?
It's a lot of burrata.
Yeah. It's a big burrata.
It's a big burrata, you guys.
What? So what's the deal with burrata cheese? I mean, I've probably had it before. What is the big deal with the, what's the big deal with the burrata?
You know, burrata is like the two best things, mozzarella and cream. So it's fresh mozzarella mixed with cream and then stuffed inside of more mozzarella. I mean, it's you know, it's delicious.
It almost looks like a fruit salad a la mode with chocolate syrup.
It's a burrata parfait.
That's what it is, guys, with miso.
With miso, yeah.
Oh my gosh, that does look amazing.
That looks great.
That's picture worthy. That is picture worthy. Okay,
right, that's it, guys.
Back to you guys.
All right.
So at the moment, we're sauteing a little bit of Ludovico Farms chicken and some veal sweetbreads. This is gonna form the base for our dish here. Just getting nice color on there.
Yeah, this Ludovico chicken is just amazing. It's funny, we always talk about it being what chicken is supposed to taste like, but it makes a real difference when you try it. The quality of the chicken really makes a difference.
And so what do you have there in the pot?
The sweetbreads.
So these are the sweetbreads that we just roasted, a little bit of bacon lardon, and then a morel mushroom fricassee.
What exactly is a fricassee?
Fricassee is sort of, think of it as like a white braise, so a stew that's finished with cream. You know, just get everybody happy together. This is gonna be the base. So then all we're gonna do is just glaze our chicken with a sherry glaze.
And that's got a funky name too, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's called an agridoux.
Agridoux!
So a mixture of caramelized sugar, sherry vinegar, and then we add a reduction of brown chicken stock in there, so that gives it a nice savory touch to it.
That looks really nice.
I always joke that this is kind of like a French sweet and sour chicken.
Yeah.
But it doesn't take anything away from how delicious it is.
Well, but you know, that's the thing about cooking, right? You see something kind of like resembles a thing that maybe you've had a lot of, and you kind of call it. Because I've been on a line where certain things, you know, we'll change it from the menu, but we call it whatever they kind of seem to think it's what it is, but it's just funny. But that's food, right?
Yeah.
Whatever helps somebody understand your intention in the long run is what really makes it work. Nobody can understand what you're saying, then you're not communicating.
Right.
So the bottom of the dish here, we have a little bit of baby romaine lettuce from here of our farms in Waimea on the Big Island. Work with their produce a lot for what we're doing. And then we're just gonna take the nice glazed chicken here. Gonna lay
beautiful.
In these pieces. Show them off.
Beautiful. And it smells wonderful even through the mask.
Yeah.
So a little pickled pearl onions in there. A little fresh lettuce leaf.
Pea shoots.
And then pea shoots and garlic flowers from Mari's garden. So now if you built it correct, it should stay together.
Dun, dun, dun. Yeah, good job.
Hands are opening.
That is the fourth dish, which means we're done. Which also means...
time to eat.
Oh, I'll try again. It's a G word. Rhymes with bind. Starts with GR.
Ooh.
Time to...
grind.
There we go. Let's head upstairs. All right, Uncle Sam, chefs, let's recap what we did. Let's start with you guys down there.
So we've got our ahi tartare with our Moroccan spice, our eggplant chips, a little dehydrated olives and crispy shallots all mixed together. Gets mixed at the table when it's served at the restaurant.
That makes it a little bit exciting for folks at the restaurant?
Yeah, we try to keep it as interactive as possible, you know, with of course, social distancing.
Of course.
For now.
And then the second thing we did?
So we had the poached egg and asparagus, the Chervil Nage, a Gruyere chip, and a little bit of a truffle herb salad.
Can we pass it on over to us? Uncle Sam, what did we do?
Well, the burrata's rolling, so we had some burrata cheese. Some nice tropical, fruits. Had a great mango, pineapple, some strawberries, and then flavored it up with a little cumin, olive oil. And then we had the bok choy, which is kind of like a curveball, but then it came out great. The miso sauce, heavy cheese, some burratas.
And then we passed the baton back to you guys for the final leg of the race, and you guys made?
Ludovico farm chicken, roasted in the sweet and sour glaze with sherry vinegar. Morel fricassee with some sweetbreads, a little bit of lettuce from here, Bar Farms.
But it's not often that you guys actually get to sit down and have a meal of your own.
It's no. Very far and in between.
Once a week?
You're welcome.
Thank you.
La Vie Restaurant, you guys are open, doing dining in, of course, adhering to social distancing and all the rules that apply right now, but serving up some of the greatest food. Tell me about the restaurant a little bit.
You know, we're open air, so we have that working in our benefit, especially right now with everything going on. And, we've been open for almost a year, technically, with the shutdown in between. And you know, the idea is to do French cuisine, but with a modern interpretation of it. And chefs curated a menu of about 15, 16 items that you can build your own menu off of. So it's not just set, you get to curate that dinner and that experience that you're going to have.
Well, thank you guys so much for having us down.
Thank you.
Uncle Sam, good job.
Yeah, good job. Thank you guys so very much.
But remember,
when Sam Choy's in the kitchen,
you can do the cooking.
Chef Sam Choy.
You look worried, man. You okay?
No, it's just tight, you know?
It is. Let's get to know each other a little better.